Hello and welcome to Movie Night. I'm your host, Jonathan Paula. Unfortunately, I'm between houses and offices at the moment, so this is going to be a sort of non-traditional episode, but I have to talk about James Bond when it comes out. So let's do it. Let's talk about Spectre. Premiering in London on October 26, 2015, the 24th James Bond film is, in a word, underwhelming. Its immediate predecessor, Skyfall, was a critical darling and a smashing success, earning over $1 billion worldwide to become the most successful entry in the 50-year-old franchise. And perhaps more importantly to the context of this review, it's also my favorite Bond picture. Then there's Spectre, which despite returning director Sam Mendes' best efforts, is ultimately a disappointment. With its massive budget reportedly close to $300 million, this is one of the most expensive movies ever produced. And with the daunting scope of action and locations, it's easy to see why. Bond does more globe-trotting in the PG-13 rated film than Carmen Sandiego. The action thriller sees Daniel Craig returning for his fourth outing as a suave British secret agent, tracking down clues to uncover the mystery behind a sinister organization. After opening with the trademark gun barrel sequence, returning to its position at the start of the film where it rightfully belongs, we're treated to a wonderful single-camera move that winds through Mexico City's jubilant Day of the Dead celebration as Craig tracks his next target. This pre-titles cold open sequence is absolutely fantastic, culminating with a harrowing fight for control of a crashing helicopter over a crowd of thousands. Sam Smith's theme song, The Writing's on the Wall, goes nicely with the stylish credits, but it never hits that second gear, remaining a decidedly forgetful entry in the long line of hit-or-miss Bond theme songs. Craig looks sharp in his tailored Tom Ford suits, and is more confident and relaxed in the role than ever before. He's also a bit of a cheeky bastard, too, making quips and staying sassy in a portrayal that's closer to Sean Connery's take on the character than his previous attempts. He exudes sex appeal and strength so effortlessly, I would probably buy anything he's selling, which is good since the movie is loaded with product placement. Craig is joined by returning players Ralph Fiennes, Ben Whishaw, and Naomi Harris, who turn in great performances in their thanklessly smaller roles. Monica Bellucci appears in an all-too-brief role as a sexy widow, Dave Bautista is frightening as a brawny and quiet henchman, Lei Sudo is resourceful and gorgeous as the requisite Bond girl, while two-time Academy Award winner Christoph Waltz is featured as the primary antagonist, who turns out to be the familiar villain everyone expected him to be. He doesn't receive a proper introduction until 90 minutes into the movie, and sadly isn't given much to work with even then. Plus, Waltz desperately needs a backstory to establish his credibility. Instead, his threats land like empty promises. He needlessly taunts Bond by revealing, "It was me, James, the author of all your pain." But there's no weight behind these words. A simple flashback explaining his relationship with Bond's tumultuous past is sorely missing. Spectre is supposed to be this nefarious enterprise with global reach, but we're never shown what they're truly capable of, or what their actual motivations are behind torturing some aging 00 agent. The decision to retroactively position this organization as the master architect of all of Bond's previous missions is a huge gamble. While it has the possibility to expertly tie everything together in a meaningful way, thereby strengthening what came before, the result is quite the opposite. It feels rushed and tacked on. A failed attempt by the writers to extort an emotional connection out of an empty script. Speaking of extortion, the film's titular acronym is curiously never explained. In the earlier movies, it stood for Special Executive for Counterintelligence, Terrorism, Revenge, and Extortion. But not anymore, I guess? At 2 hours and 28 minutes, this is the longest picture in the Bond series, and oftentimes it really feels like it. Nothing is outright boring, but huge passages slog on, sans urgency. Without a ticking clock or a looming threat, there's hardly any tension during the entire middle hour of the film, which should have been trimmed down substantially. Thankfully, however, when the action does arrive, it's presented in top form. Craig finds himself in one insanely awesome set piece after the other. A high-stakes car chase over the cobblestone alleyways of Rome plays things a bit safe with the two sleek supercars, but a mountainside sequence in Austria literally takes the wings right off a plane. The choreography, stunt work, practical, and special effects are all accomplished with expert precision, brought together with clean and easy-to-follow cinematography. A hand-to-hand fight on board a speeding train is particularly well done. But I have to wonder if Bond is still a member of the Navy or the Air Force, because he skillfully pilots no less than 3 aircraft in this movie. Thomas Newman's heavier score dutifully incorporates plenty of leitmotifs of yesteryear, but the classic Bond theme is never really heard in earnest until the ending credits. An excellent climax set amongst the rubble of the old MI6 headquarters seems to be setting up another direct sequel, but whether Craig will return to the role remains to be seen. James Bond movies are a lot like sex. When it's good, it's great, and when it's bad, it's still pretty good. Spectre may be an ambitious thrill ride, but its emotional stakes are entirely superficial. Compared to Skyfall, this follow-up is an unfortunate disappointment, but it's still a pretty cool film. a fun and flashy entry in the franchise, I'd rank this one somewhere in the middle. Well, that'll do it for this makeshift episode, but Movie Night will return in full force with a special episode on the entire Rocky franchise to coincide with the release of Creed later this month. I'll also take a look at some of the films and episodes I missed during this unplanned 6-week hiatus, an episode on horror movies, Peter Pan, and more James Bond pictures. If you're curious about my situation and why I'm temporarily homeless at the moment, I did an explanation video on John's World last week, sort of explaining why I don't have my equipment, my suit, my computer, or really, my regular dig. So if you're curious about any of that, link in the description below. I hope to get back in fighting form as quick as I can with lots more reviews, so stay tuned for that. My name is Jonathan Paula. Thank you, as always, for watching and listening. And until next time, have a good movie night.